Good morning and good afternoon, everyone. I'm Michael Booker from StageGate International, and thank you for joining our webinar today with Colin Palumbo, Innovation Strategy, Responding to the New Realities. I am pleased to introduce you to Colin. Colin is an engineering computer science graduate from the University of Cambridge with a master's in business and innovation from INSEAD. He's an entrepreneur who's enjoyed success innovating in the software industry for the last 15 years, and has begun integrating many techniques like Agile and jobs to be done into innovation management frameworks like StageGate. Colin leads our global consulting practice and will deliver our webinar today from his Miami office. Today's presentation is about 30 minutes with about 20 minutes of presentation by Colin, followed by Q&A. Everyone has been muted, so please submit your questions directly to me privately through the chat function in Zoom. And without further ado, Colin, over to you. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Michael. Hi, everybody. Good morning. Hope you're all safe and well. We are going to cover today a situation that everyone is facing right now. And what that means is, let's have a quick look. Back in 2019, certainly in the United States, things were looking fairly rosy for innovation. Executive teams would have put together their plans for 2020. Their innovation strategy was probably very well thought out, and things were looking good in the United States. We had record low unemployment. We had record highs in company valuation, and we had a wealth of new technologies. There are a wealth of new technologies that continue to drive profitable growth for businesses and companies. Now, as we all very well aware of, that changed. That changed in 2020 with the COVID crisis. And that really is a rapid and uncertain economic shock. Now, what we've observed is that we've been through this before in terms of an economic shock. And many executives who are making these decisions have been through at least two of these shocks before. The first around 2001, 2002 with the 9/11 and the dot-com crash. And then again in the financial crisis of 2008-2009. So both of those are economic shocks, and I think what we're seeing is that experienced executives know that they have to respond rapidly to the new reality. I think what's slightly different this time is that COVID is far bigger and more global than any other shock we've seen previously, and is likely to permanently change market dynamics for quite some time. I think the Congressional Budget Office in the United States estimated this has at least a 10-year impact on the US economy. And the other scale of this is, in other crises, unemployment in the United States again may have increased from 4% in the financial crisis to 10%. In COVID, we've gone from 3.5% to nearly 15%. It's a quite dramatic change. Now, as we all know, it's not bad for everybody. The new reality is that there have been losers and winners in this change. Just as an example, I'm sure many of you are now buying more stuff online. Amazon stock has gone up 30% since January 1st of this year. And like us, as we're doing now, we're using Zoom. Zoom is now worth more than the top seven global airlines combined. So clearly there are winners and losers in this new reality. So the question is, what we're going to cover today is what should your new innovation strategy be? How can executives quickly align to the direction they need to take and then place bets, put money on the investments for their innovation to make that direction actually enacted in funding? So that's what we're going to cover today. Just as a reminder, those executives that don't react and respond and just think this is business as usual, I think it's fairly predictable what that outcome is going to be. And really, Jack Welch summarized this in Other Times very nicely. If the rate of change on the outside, meaning if your competitors are changing faster than the rate of change on the inside in a highly uncertain and market-changing environment, then the end is near. So what we're seeing is those executive teams that do respond rapidly and decisively tend to generate far more value for the company than those that have not. So innovation strategy is not to us a PowerPoint deck or a set of slides. Innovation strategy becomes real, as we like to say, when you start spending money. So innovation strategy is really how executives allocate money and people to innovation initiatives, and that defines your strategy. And what we're going to cover today is just three steps or three ways of rethinking that in light of COVID. The first is, what's the implication on the total size of investment that your company should be making around innovation? Second is, once the size of the pie is fixed, how should you best allocate that to different areas of innovation, different classifications of projects or initiatives that will start focusing your strategy? And then the third thing we're going to look at today is what we call our product market fit landscape, the StageGate International product market fit landscape, which is a version of a modified Ansoff matrix. And that's really going to investigate, based on the allocation, which project should we now be funding based on our new direction. So let's drill in. Let's kick off with the budget. The first question. Again, reflecting back on 2019, in that environment, I'm sure many organizations have put together their plans for the 2020 financial or calendar year and have agreed a certain amount of investment. They may have done that typically on prior years plus or minus a couple of percent. They may be doing it on a percentage of revenues of the business, but somehow they've come up with a total number that they should be spending in 2020 and beyond. That's changed, and I'm sure every single organization has thought about that budget and how it needs to be changed to accommodate the new realities. And really, they've got four choices here that you can make. The very first is hold steady. Do we believe that in our environment, in our business, we can continue the course of what we believed in 2019? We can more or less keep the same budget, and we more or less can carry on with the same set of investment projects in our portfolio that we believe were right. My biggest concern with that strategy is the quote from Jack Welch, and that the world has changed quite dramatically, and does hold steady actually mean you're not responding effectively? In responding, you've got three choices then. You can cut significantly. If cash needs to be conserved and survival is what you're trying to accomplish, then clearly cutting innovation budgets is one source of doing that. Knowing full well that any cut to innovation budgets has an impact for your longer term future competitiveness, as innovation drives future competitive advantage and growth. If you have sufficient financial strength, but you need to dramatically pivot to different investment portfolio, that's a reallocate option. We can keep our budgets roughly at the same level, but we need to dramatically alter where we're spending that money to impact our business results in the way we need them to. And the fourth option for those companies lucky enough to be in a business or a situation where there are many opportunities to expand your business, you've got sufficient financial strength to invest in that, then maybe now is the time to go on the offense, increase your innovation budget, and focus on new opportunities to increase revenues, grow your competitive advantage, and acquire scarce talent. So it comes down to pretty much four opportunities: stay steady, cut, reallocate, or expand. And that's what we're seeing in most organizations we work with. What I like to do is actually ask the participants to take a quick poll. And I'm sure all of your organizations have already gone through a decision about what to do in 2020. And could you select which one of these four is the most similar to what you've decided to do? So if you could go on and just take a quick poll and click what you think. Michael, can you? I can see the poll results real time. Can you? I'm just seeing if this is presented.
Yep, we'll give folks a couple more seconds and then we'll end the polling and show the results. And I'm going to end the polling.
And oh, that's interesting.
That is sharing the results.
Okay, so that shows there are some people are lucky enough, perhaps, that they could believe they can hold steady. Cut significantly, quite understandable. But equally, 50% of respondents say we can maintain the levels of funding, but we need to reallocate rapidly or indeed grow. So that shows quite a balance of responses across those four. Very good. I'll stop sharing those results and close the poll. All right, so that's the first conversation that I'm sure all your executive teams have had as per what you've just discussed. What we need to do next then is think about how we can allocate that investment to meet our particular objectives in the next year and the next term. So next we're going to discuss not the size of the total innovation investment pie, but how you want to allocate it. And what we recommend is that executives first consider a classification system that ties this investment directly back to their financial statements and their financial results as a business. Because that then means it's a very easy story to tell of how innovation strategy aligns to corporate results. And three classifications start with the first segment here shown in green, is what we call top line projects. A top line project is any project that will sustain and grow the top line of your profit and loss statement, meaning your revenue. So these are projects that generate and sustain revenue for your business. That could be providing new or improved solutions to your current customers. That could mean targeting new customers that you've not served before with your technologies and capabilities. So that's a revenue growth strategy. The second quadrant we're going to look at is the other end of the profit and loss, which is bottom line projects. These are projects that typically cut cost, increase profit and EBITDA for your business. Examples of that would be taking cost innovation projects that take cost out of your products, take cost out of your business processes and operations, take cost out of your production and supply chain. And nowadays, many of these bottom line projects relate to this catch-all term called digital transformation and automation. But that's not limited to that, but very often that's where a lot of digital transformation projects fall. Incidentally, if you're doing digital transformation of your products and solutions, those should actually fall into the green segment here of generating more revenue. The third slice of this pie is what we call balance sheet projects. And the reason we call them balance sheet is that they actually spend money to gain or build assets. Assets which are intellectual property, assets which are knowledge, assets which are capabilities, which cost money to get, but ultimately would enable future bottom line projects or top line projects. And we call them balance sheet projects because accounting principles would allow it, we could actually identify the value of these as an asset, an intangible asset on the balance sheet. Example of that are research projects that de-risk technologies to see if they're viable for your business and your customers. And anything that acquires a capability that does not directly yield bottom line or top line profitability.
Colin.
So those are three options. Oh, sorry.
Oh, yes, Colin, yeah, those three options. Can you have more than three options? Are you able to slice and dice this pie in other ways, into other buckets, different classifications?
Absolutely. Yeah, so we often recommend up to three different classification techniques or systems to look at innovation and innovation strategy. You've typically got to pick a major and two minor. The major one is the principal one that you want to allocate your funding between. And this is what this percentage means. We know our total budget, then you actually estimate what the percentages should be targeted for those. But you can actually have other classification systems as well, two minor ones, and they are often used for balancing of this initial decision. And there are several examples of what those could be related to: types of technology, could be related to product lines, could be related to customer segments, could be related to business lines. But the reason why we like these three first and foremost is that they tie very cleanly, directly back to the financial results of the company. So what executives need to do with this chart is make a decision. They need to decide on the relative investment across these scenarios. So for example, if you see many opportunities in the market and you've got the financial strength to do so, you may want to over allocate on top line projects. You may say, well, let's invest 60% of our money there, 20% in bottom line, and 20% in balance sheet projects. Conversely, if you're very focused on cutting cost, you may have had a more balanced portfolio in 2019. Now you say, well, actually, we've got to invest 60 to 80% or 80% in bottom line. We're going to only keep 10% in the other two. So this should be a top-down decision. Where we see this done incorrectly, if you like, or done poorly, is where really executives just roll up the projects they have, assign them to these segments, and that's their strategy. So that's really defining strategy by the set of investments you historically have made. It's not defining a strategy by looking forward. So that's what we recommend there. It ties closely to financial results of the company. So it's very easy to explain to your board of directors, your chief executive officer, your stakeholders, why you've allocated that. And it helps executives think about it in these ways so that they can simplify their choices around where to place their bets. We're now going to take the third step, which is actually to drill down a layer further. And let's now look at what we do with the allocation. And we're going to focus on one of these quadrants for now, or one of these segments. We're going to look at top line projects, revenue generating projects, but you can use the same technique for the other segments as well. We're going to now ask the question, okay, this is my amount of money, a portion of my total budget that I want to spend on revenue growth and revenue maintenance. Where should I spend that? Which project should I spend that on to be the most effective return on my investment? And what we use here is I'm sorry for these lines, I'm not sure how those were on there, but let's just move on. StageGate International uses a modified product market fit landscape that I'm showing you here in this gray box. On the y-axis is the customer needs and the customer jobs to be done that you target, ranging from the existing customers you serve now, all the way through to new customers that you may want to serve. On the x-axis is the solutions and technology that you could offer. And again, the range starts from the origin with the existing solutions and technology you deliver, all the way through to adjacent and new technologies that you could start providing to serve those customer segments. So just an example here, anything in the bottom left quadrant would be existing products to existing customers. That's your core business right now. Any investments down there in the bottom left would really be just minor improvements to those products to keep them fresh, keep them competitive. Anything on the bottom right would be serving your existing customer base with brand new technology or solutions, stuff that you've never done before, is highly unfamiliar to you, but you are delivering it into a very familiar market. So that's the overall landscape itself. Let's just take a step lower and go one level further. The two questions that executives can use this visualization to address is really the essence of strategy on the battlefields you want to play and win in. Which customer segments do we want to play? Where do we play? That's a choice. You don't get to define what customers want, but you do get to choose and define what those customer segments are and whether you can serve them and win. The second question is how to win. What solutions and technology and services, for example, can we provide, either ones we currently do or ones that we should think about doing, that will allow us to win in those customer segments? So this is really what the landscape is used for. It's asking these two questions: where to play and how to win.
So Colin, you talk about customer needs here. How would this landscape modify or change if we're looking for internal innovation?
Great question. So we've focused on the segment of top line projects. You can use the same landscape, again, using effectively supply and demand. Supply is the solutions and technology. Demand is the customer service, customer needs you serve. For internal projects, the customer then tends to be the business processes and the internal employees that you could serve with technology solutions. So where to play there is a discussion about how best we can apply technology to cut costs. Does it mean that we can automate? Does it mean that we can use ways of cutting time and cost out of our supply chain? So that's another way of using this model. It's just changing the y-axis to be not the external customer, but the internal customer and the internal process that has cost associated with it. And then on the other, the third quadrant was the balance sheet projects. They also can be plotted on this because they enable solutions here. So typically, new technologies would be investigating and de-risking technologies on the far right of the x-axis, or investing and doing deep market research to understand customer needs, which would be the top of the y-axis. So let's just take this one level further now, and let's see how this plays out in a given business. So on that, you should be able to define customer segments on the y-axis that you are currently serving. That's shown here, customer segment 1, 2, and 3. Customer segments that you may have targeted that are adjacent, meaning they're to the customer segments that are existing. And then new, which are customer segments 6 and 7 here. And then you should be able to take your current investment portfolio, your current innovation projects, and plot them on this landscape, identifying which customer segments they have been targeted to serve, and which technologies they are using, either existing capabilities, solutions, and technologies, or new or adjacent technologies that you're using to win in those customer segments. Now, the news here is, basing this back to the original question, the new reality, unless you are one of those survey that said, stay the course, it's highly likely that your y-axis has changed. I'll say that again, your y-axis has probably changed post-COVID-19. And just in terms of two simple questions, the total addressable market size of that customer segment could have collapsed or could have expanded. So market size would have changed based on how your customers have reacted or are impacted by the new reality of this economic shock. The second thing is the actual desires and outcomes within that customer segment would have changed as well for your solutions. The priorities that they're placing now on what they want may have changed as well. So in effect, what that means is what you thought was familiar and well understood and certain with your customer, existing customer segments, may have actually shifted up this y-axis and have become less familiar and less certain. So one of the key questions this landscape poses to executives is, we knew where we were playing before. This was all pretty good. We were in steady, not steady state, but well-defined, well-understood back in 2019. That has changed most definitely. We need, as an executive team, to be very clear on how that's changed and retarget our focus on those segments that are expanding and those segments whose needs have evolved in a way that we can best serve with our solutions. The second question this allows us to visualize then is also, because of that changing on the y-axis, by definition, how you address those markets and how you win at those markets may need to change as well. So once you've understood and defined that new customer segment or the dynamics of that customer segment, you may need to reevaluate how you're serving that segment with your solutions and technology. Do we need a massive shift into Internet of Things and remote sensing? You've probably done that already, but are there other ways that because of remote working or other dynamics of your customer segments that require you to serve that customer segment in a different way than you had originally planned in 2019? Now, there's an awful lot more to this landscape than I can cover in a 15-minute web meeting. But what this does provide is a very powerful and visual way for executives to think about their product market fit and how that would have changed in this new reality and how they can reallocate investment, literally defunding projects and focusing money on new projects in the particular custom segments and the technologies that you believe you need now to win. So with that, just to wrap this up, a simple but powerful framework for shifting your innovation strategy is based on where you start spending money differently to how you were planning to do it back in 2019. Has your budget changed? Have you allocated that to three classifications of spend that tie this very clearly back to your financial statements and corporate results? And then within each of those, how do we look at that spend for individual projects on a market product market landscape fit? Being able to address the question, where should we play now, given the new reality? And how should we win now, given the new reality? And to summarize all of that, that all sounds great. It's a very nice sort of neat consulting framework. We fully understand and work with organizations that this requires a change of mindset. And as John Maynard Keynes said, as one of the leading 19th century economists, the difficulty lies not so much in developing these frameworks or these new ideas, it's actually escaping from the old ones. So I would certainly challenge, hopefully, those people who said that they're staying the course, you're not falling into this trap, but you've actually premeditated, thought about it, and fully aligned that staying the course is absolutely the right thing to do going forward. Just to sum this up, if you want to find out more about this technique, obviously you can contact me at colinpalumbo@stagegate.com. Our methodology is documented and been peer reviewed. That's the whole point of Stagegate International. That's our competitive advantage. You can go out and get the book Product Innovation and Technology Strategy by Cooper and Edgett. That summarizes, but no means has all the detail behind some of the concepts that I've presented today. And with that, we have a few minutes left for any questions.
Thanks, Colin. Yes, we have one question that I think we can get to. The other questions, thank you. We will follow up directly with you. Question, Colin, should we have different processes for the different projects, top line, bottom line, balance sheet?
Great question. And I'm actually going to go, what we didn't get into, because it's such a powerful thing here, is this matrix also represents a risk matrix as well. The further you get to the top right, the higher degree of uncertainty you have in what customers want and how the technologies could best serve them. So if you operationalize this, when we go beyond strategy to look at execution of your new product development process, you would pick a different stage gate process, not just for cost reduction versus new revenue versus balance sheet projects, but also potentially, for example, here, I would look to a 5-stage process for my higher risk projects. I would look to a 3-stage process for my lower risk projects. And in some cases, effectively a 1-stage process, which means just we agree on the scope, just go do it for some of the projects that are existing. So that, reflecting back on stage, the Stagegate new product development process just right sizes the degree of governance to the degree of risk being taken on by that type of project.
Thanks, Colin. And I think we're at our time limit. So over to you for concluding remarks. And thank you everyone for your questions. We will reply directly to the rush to the questions.
And Michael, we'll send out this deck to everyone, right?
Yeah, we'll get that in the next day or so.
Okay, and if you could, you've got my email. If you've got a question you'd just like to follow up with me on, please send me an email. Very quickly, next webinar in our StageGate series is actually a special one, a unique one. We actually have a guest speaker, and it's a slightly extended presentation. Tuesday, June 9th, 10 a.m. to 10:45 EAT, Eastern Time, focuses on voice of customer. How does voice of customer change or can be changed in this new world? That's going to be facilitated by Bernd Becker. And our guest speaker is Kip Creel, who's been in the VOC space for many years. So he'll be presenting his insights there. And with that, thank you very much.